move now to our first panel of 2019, and this is about views of the next generation. So I'm going to introduce our panelists. Bethel Afewerk, who is a student at the University of Calgary and a technical writer. Matthew Merringer, Durham Chapter President and Canadian Affairs Chair with North American Young Generation in Nuclear. And Taylor McKenna, Project Manager with Ontario's Nuclear Advantage. Now, all of them have longer bios than that, but they're in the conference app, so I encourage you to read them there. I want to save as much time as possible to hear from them and not read long introductions. So maybe you can each start by talking about why you work in the nuclear industry and how you ended up doing so and what you've done so far. Taylor? I think it'll be okay.
Okay, perfect. So I got into the nuclear industry for a couple of reasons, but one reason specifically was growing up, I spent a lot of my time in and out of the hospital on oxygen masks with asthma. And in 2014, when Ontario phased off of coal thanks to nuclear power, my life changed forever. So I'm here in the industry advocating for the positive role nuclear power plays for our province. And that's part of my job.
That's great. And tell us a little bit about what you do with Ontario's Nuclear Advantage and what your passion is with that work.
So Ontario's Nuclear Advantage is an advocacy campaign organized by a lot of people actually in the room, CNA, OPG, Bruce Power, Hatch, Layuna, a lot of us in the industry. And what we do is we figure out ways how we can advocate to the government, Ontario's government, but also to people outside of the industry so the message is getting across Ontario. So we have great success through our Ontario's Nuclear Advantage newsletter that everyone can sign up to on our website. And we also have success with we're started a new thing where we're doing a ONA video channel as well that will be live as of next week. So we're really trying to get the message out there, and people outside of the industry is our main focus.
Okay. Matthew, let's turn to you and tell us how you got into the industry and why.
So I wish I had as good of a story as Taylor there, but unfortunately I do not. I really looked for jobs. I wanted a job for life. I wanted a unionized, stable job. And then I wanted to have something that I was proud of. I wanted a challenge in university, so I went to nuclear engineering, and I was just amazed at actually the energy density. You could literally take something out of the ground, basically turn it into a ceramic pellet, put it in a tank of water, and essentially you have this almost unlimited source of energy. So I was just so proud to be in the nuclear industry, and my secret reason as well is I wanted to go down to California, I wanted to escape winter, and but unfortunately, Grand Diablo and San Onofre didn't quite make it. So California didn't share my vision for a long nuclear, but.
Right, yeah. And tell us a little bit about what you do.
So I work full-time at Ontario Power Generation. I'm a senior advisor in stakeholder relations. So when WANO comes down and IEA, I basically line up the site for those evaluations. But for North American Young Generation and Nuclear, I am the Canadian Affairs Chair. For those of you who don't know what NAYGN is, it's a nonprofit organization with over 120 chapters across North America. And essentially, it's to energize the future nuclear leaders. So we put on professional development seminars, we do facility tours, we advocate to the government from a young perspective. We actually go to schools as well. So we developed this children's book a couple of years back. So it's Marie's Electric Adventure. And coming out soon is the next revision. So we send these to libraries, we do school readings, we do teacher workshops as well, we have an essay contest at schools, we have a drawing contest for elementary students as well, but we also get members together through membership events as well, so we'll go to a TFC game or a Jays game. Really, it's just about bringing together that community and helping out the nuclear industry there.
And what's the message from the outreach to children through that book and through other initiatives that you just mentioned?
So really, it's all about getting people to know about nuclear at an early age. We find if they start to know about it after, you know, university or high school, it's too late. They've already made up their mind or they've already picked a different career. So we really want to talk to them about it at an early age, you know, share with them what nuclear is about, and that's not as scary. And that's what this book is, Marie Curie and her dog Einstein go on an adventure together and to find out that when the power goes out, that nuclear isn't as scary as they thought it was. So it's just about introducing the topic. We found that really starting that conversation people are more open to it, and the earlier start, the better.
Okay. Good stuff. Bethel, let's hear from you on what you're doing and why you chose the path that you've chosen.
Okay, so currently I'm a student at the University of Calgary, and I was always interested in going into a major that had something to do with renewable energy or helping out climate change, because that's one thing I was always passionate about growing up. So currently I'm majoring in energy science and communication, and how I got into nuclear was through my professor, some of you may know, Jason Donov, and he runs a website called energyeducation.ca. So our aim is to be engaging and spark curiosity among people that don't really have a science background on energy topics, and so they can learn more about it. And so last summer, I had the opportunity of being a technical writer and editor, and actually that last summer, we also launched a video project where we want to make short, informative videos with light boards, essentially just tutorials and just spark curiosity amongst the public on what nuclear energy is and the science behind it.
And I know you have a passion for the arts as well,
yes,
right?
Yes, I do.
And you aspire to become an entrepreneur and combine your passion for the arts with your interest in sustainable energy, right?
Yes.
Tell us about that.
I hope to make a creative space one day, but I'm also hoping to advocate to make sure that creative space is run by 100% renewables and is completely sustainable. So that also comes with attempting to advocate for nuclear energy in Alberta, as we are the highest coal-using province. And I know that even if Calgary is the sunniest city in, you know, Canada, it's not going to be enough to just use solar. So I think it's those videos we hope to outreach to people in Alberta and across Canada and the world to promote, you know, the use of nuclear, as that's really going to help our climate and
right.
climate problem.
But just describe a little more that vision that you have of what you want to accomplish as an entrepreneur.
I just want a space for artists to come in and essentially have a space to work and do workshops and also attend events. But I also want people to come in and be able to see a large brick and mortar building that's using various sustainable sources and resources to run.
Okay, great. So let's talk about how your peers react, how your friends who aren't in the nuclear industry react to the fact that you are, and what messages you share with others about the work that you're doing in the industry itself. Matthew?
Yeah, so I think it really depends on listening. So you really ask them first on what their impression is, and you find out what their concerns are, and you address it. I think sometimes we're so defensive, we jump out in front, and we're like, listen to all these facts, and we just spew it to them. Sometimes it's nice to just sit back, ask them what they think. Sometimes they're already on board, they just have a follow-up question, you know, what do we do with the waste, or what about isotopes, or what about SMRs? I think it's really about listening and then working with them for their specific concerns. So it's giving them the information that they really need, and not, as a defensive industry, throwing that. Because when we start to throw that forward and, you know, talk about safety and some of these other kind of talking points that we have, sometimes that gets to an uncomfortable situation where they feel like we're being defensive. So I think it's active listening and then working with them for their specifics.
Okay. Taylor?
Yeah, I agree with Matthew. And I also think it's really important. A lot of my friends say, why nuclear? So it's really important to educate them about clean, reliable energy, and also to really talk about, I like to talk about the medical isotope side of things. I think it's a really great message that we as an industry should keep bringing up and talking about, because people resonate with it for sure.
Okay, Bethel?
Mm-hmm. When I speak to people about it, yeah, you're totally right, Matthew, about not being so defensive. And I do ask them, like, what is your opinion on nuclear first, and really seeing where it goes from there. And I also ask them if they are very fearful, a lot of people say, of radiation or nuclear power plant accidents. I always start with the question, well, name me nuclear power plant accidents, right? And then you hear, you know, the Chernobyl, the Three Mile Island, the Fukushima, and then you ask them, well, how many oil and gas spills, natural gas spills were there this year? How much do you know impacted our environment? And then that really starts breaking down the conversation of nuclear fears, because a lot of people don't realize places like Ontario is majority nuclear, and places like France is pretty much almost all nuclear. So when you start telling people, like, oh, well, this is actually already happening. It's not something that's, you know, in the dark, in the shadows. It's already happening. And it's actually much safer than you may think it is.
Matthew, what do you hear in terms of perceptions among people who aren't in the industry?
I definitely believe there is a shift to more acceptance. When you start to talk about the isotopes, which I think everyone's behind, the life-saving isotopes that nuclear produces, and the real innovation that's starting to drive it forward, the SMRs, and just making the existing nuclear power plants safer and more efficient, I think they're starting to get on board. We don't have this generation that grew up with Chernobyl and Three Mile Island. It's a more open generation, I find, that climate change is a huge concern. And actually, through NAYGN, if anyone's curious what millennials think, every 2 years we come up with a career report. So we send this out to all members across North America about job satisfaction, future outlook. It's broken down by gender, broken down by age. So this is publicly available on the NAYGN website as well. And you can see we trended across the years, and the regional outlook is getting better for members. They say they're more hopeful for nuclear in the future. Their job satisfaction is going up. So I think across the nuclear industry and outside as well, viewing in towards nuclear, it's getting more positive.
What else is in there that you think is interesting? What else did you find talking to people?
There still is a gender gap, but it's not as big as people think compared to the rest of the industry. As well, 86% of respondents were very satisfied or satisfied with their job, so I think there's great numbers there as well. And of those identified, 96% said that they were determined to accomplish their goals, and 90% said that they were confident to meet those goals as well. So I think it's a very positive outlook, and we've seen an increase over the 14 years we've been doing that.
We're going to hear at lunchtime from David Coletto of Abacus Data, who's an expert on Canadian millennials, and he's going to be sharing some insights into that. But I know one of the things he talks about is the fact that the climate change is obviously a huge concern to millennials, as it is to people in other generations, but particularly among millennials. Is there, Taylor, do you think there is an opportunity there for the nuclear industry in reaching out to young people and underscoring the advantages of nuclear as a renewable source of energy in a time when everyone's concerned about climate change?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think with what Ontario's Nuclear Advantage is doing is we're trying to find ways to get the message out there to the millennials. And so we're doing this Ontario's Nuclear Advantage video channel so we can get these millennials on Facebook and Twitter and Instagram and LinkedIn so they could see what's going on in the industry in a positive way. And getting that message out there and sharing it with their friends and family and making sure that that message is out there to everyone, especially our millennial age, for sure.
Yeah. Bethel, what else have you learned from listening to people, listening to their perspectives on nuclear?
I think one thing that I have noticed is that a lot of it is fear-mongering, and that I think it is a generational gap in what we're so used to doing. You think that's the best way. Like, sometimes you're so afraid of change, from the fear of wanting consistency. But I think that there is a huge learning gap, and that we can close in the industry, and that's what us at Energy Education are really aiming to do. We have thousands of people coming to our sites every day, and we notice that it does follow high school student trends and such, so we know that it's not just adults that are using this, it is definitely much younger people as well. So I think it's really allowing to have more open information out there that will really help that knowledge gap close.
Do you think we need to change the way we talk about nuclear energy and the nuclear industry, Matthew?
Definitely. I think that's a consensus across the industry. It's got to be more positive. It's got to be more towards the future. We can't keep doing the things we're doing in the States. You see they're slowly closing the nuclear reactors down there. We need to be looking for refurb. We need to be looking for new build. And we need to be playing the positives. What can nuclear do to help the problems of society? Asthma, so respiratory problems in Ontario, we've seen a great trend to reducing smog. So it's talking about these positives that the nuclear bring and not always being, like I said before, being so defensive. So it's being optimistic, it's putting a positive spin on it, and it's really about engaging them at a younger age. If we want to start to get the nuclear leaders of tomorrow, we have to start talking to them at a younger age. We can't let them know about it grade 11, grade 12 physics. We have to start even earlier, for especially some of the provinces that don't have nuclear in their backyard. It's different talking in Pickering to some of the schools because they know about it, they see it, their parents work there, or their colleagues, or their friends. But for these other provinces that may not have access to that, it's really letting them know just the basic fundamentals as well, how radiation works. So maybe even bringing a Geiger counter and showing that, you know, clay is radioactive, or that a handful of Brazil nuts is radioactive. It's really putting in that perspective so they can understand it more.
Okay. Taylor, what do you think? What's your advice to the industry on changing the messaging?
Well, I agree with Matthew. I think we really need to get into the school programs and to educate these young individuals about the positive role nuclear power plays in the job creation and the skilled trade jobs that are available in the industry. And also to get women out there and females and say it's a great industry to be in, amazing opportunities for everyone. And yeah, I think that's...
Yeah. I think it's interesting, Matthew, that you mentioned that the accessibility of it. You know, when you ask kids under a certain age what do they want to be, most of them say they want to be a teacher because they see somebody teaching every day, right? But they don't see somebody, or they might say police officer or firefighter because those people are present in their midst. But they don't say, I want to work in the nuclear industry because it's just not familiar to them, right? Especially if they're not in a province that has nuclear energy or a nearby nuclear facility.
They know it from The Simpsons, so.
That's right, yeah.
That's...
Yeah, which there's pluses and minuses to that, how it's portrayed on The Simpsons, I think. What do you think, Bethel?
I think that, of course, we need to focus on the positives, but I think that people start getting weary when you just focus on positives, so I think it's really making a pros and cons list for them and comparing it to all the sources we have right now. And you'll realize nuclear has so many pros compared to like fossil fuels, and it's much more energy dense, and it's not intermittent like other it's not really a renewable source, but it's not really intermittent, and it's carbon free and such. So being able to present both sides and asking people, well, you decide, right? Like you make the decision. Do you want carbon in our atmosphere, or do you want something that's extremely energy dense and is carbon free essentially, and we could essentially solve our climate crisis with it. So I think showing both sides will allow people to really take a step back and realize maybe it's not as terrible as they thought it was.
Yeah. Do you have any other advice, any of you, for the people leading in the industry on how we can attract more young people? Matthew?
I would say look what's already out there. So there's women in nuclear, there's scientists in school, there's NAYGN, there's ONA, there's CNA, there's all these groups already out there, and tap into what's already being done. So don't try and reinvent the wheel. Don't think that you have to start your own youth program or do anything drastically different. Go to the programs already out there, the people already doing what they're doing, and let's all go together to do that. We had a great partnership when we showed the New Fire movie, which is a brilliant film about the promise of nuclear for tomorrow, from someone that was against nuclear at the start that switched over to a nuclear advocate. And when we showed that for NAYGN, we partnered with OCNI, CNS, UIT, and Women in Nuclear. So it's all something that we had a common objective, was showing this positive nuclear movie in Oshawa. And we partnered together. I think that's how we can get better as an industry, is find these partnerships out there, find what's already being done, and not have to start from scratch.
Bethel, did you want to add to that?
Yeah, so I think that as a university student, I think it'd be so helpful if people that are in programs like energy science or nuclear engineering go to junior highs or high schools and actually talk to the kids there as part of possibly the program there as an outreach or as volunteer hours. It's a really great experience because I think that if someone in their low to mid-20s was talking to a junior high or a high school student, it's much more personable than maybe a much older adult. So I think that really getting in there when they're young, like you said, and promoting things like NAYGN and such to the young people that are interested in this to really promote it in schools, I think, would be very helpful.
Taylor?
Yeah, and I agree with the both of them. I think supporting each other in the industry and our amazing programs that we have, and also getting into the education side and going into those schools and really educating the next generation about this industry and how amazing it is.
Okay, let's talk about the future of the industry and from your vantage point and what you experience and what you've learned, where do you see the industry going in Canada? What do you envision? Bethel?
Well, I hope nuclear becomes a huge part of the forefront for our coal phase out, especially in Alberta. I don't see any way, other way of doing it, really. There needs to be some nuclear in there. And if Canada is really aiming to reduce their emissions drastically by 2030 or whatever they were saying, nuclear is going to have to be part of the picture, and it's going to be a large part of it. And I think that a lot of people forget that they're fearful of possibly losing a lot of jobs in the coal or natural gas industry. And I mean, there will be jobs that are lost inevitably, but also there is so much training and there is a very large transition that can happen for people already having jobs. So it's not like we're forgetting about, you know, our already employed workers. We're looking out for everyone. And I think it's being able to do a slow step, smooth transition, not something so drastic, because that'll probably cause a lot of differential problems and stuff, yeah.
Okay, Matthew?
So I see it in two ways. I think we still have to focus on refurbishment. You know, this is going to keep Ontario powered for the future. We also have to look to new build as well. This is something that I feel has kind of been put on the back burner for now. I think we need to start paying a lot more attention to that. If we're actually serious, SMRs are great, but we need that big, reliable backbone to be built in the future, especially in Ontario. The second part is getting that across Canada. So the grids that can't support a regular full-size reactor, that's where I see SMRs taking the place. Expanding that to other Canadians that may not know about it, introducing them to it, it's almost like a sample size. You get a small reactor, see how it is. So if you're Saskatchewan or Alberta, some of these other provinces that have never had it, they can see the benefits that SMRs provide, and then maybe longer term they can look at a full-size CANDU or other type of technology. But I think that's the two phases, is new build and then continue with refurbishment, and then for the future, SMRs. And then SMRs also unlock that potential for district heating because it's a higher heat source. So there's so much other advantages from that as well that those can provide to communities.
Yeah. Taylor, what do you expect to happen?
Yeah, and I agree with Matthew. I think we really need to focus on our refurbishment projects and be successful with that so we can look into SMRs. And I think that we have a great Nuclear Innovation Institute coming up for a research hub for new technology and new innovation. And I think just continuing with focusing on our refurbishments and getting that done as a successful story.
Mm-hmm. Regarding SMRs, Matthew, how soon and how many, you know, how do you see that rolling out?
As many as possible.
Yeah.
But I'm not an expert on SMRs, so I won't talk too much about it. But I'm really excited for the new technologies that they have, so U-Battery and Terrestrial Energy and some of these others that are coming out. I think it's going to be slow to start, so I think mid-2020s at Chalk River as well at that site, have this demonstration unit out there, and then start to enroll them. But I'm hopeful for at least a few SMRs to be built before 2030. That's I think that would be a win, and then transition to as many as we can after that if they're successful.
Okay. So to wrap up, I want to give each of you an opportunity to to speak to the people in this room, big group of people who are the leaders in the nuclear industry in Canada, and leave them with one message about the future of the industry and the role of young people in the industry in that future. So Bethel, what would you say?
The future is bright. Keep conversations going. Be sure to always ask the person questions and really start from where they are at with the nuclear industry if you're talking to someone about it. But remember that, like, when I did my research, I think it said like 60-70% of people change their mind after a short conversation about nuclear energy. So it's a lot of misled information. It's a lot of fear-mongering, you know, imposed by mass media. So a lot of the times and now that we have social media. So I think it's just so important to keep the conversation going, emphasize that we're really just here to help the climate change problem, and we're all just trying to work together to make sure our planet is still here.
Okay. Taylor?
Yeah, I think it's great that we need to start educating the young individuals and getting out there and talking to our family and our friends about the positive role nuclear power plays so that we're all on the same page as a province.
Okay, Matthew?
I really want to plug the Tipping Point by Gladwell. I think it's a great book that talks about how to influence change. He talks about making mavens and influencers. And I think the message, who delivers the message, is important as well. So you can't have these CEOs or these people from a different generation going to some of the younger folks to really influence change. You have to have the grassroots organizations, like Relatable Generation, talk to them. That there's that trust that's built when the deliverer is not working from an agenda. So if they're from a nonprofit group or they're from the same generation, I think that is how you start to influence change, that trust that they put in you.
Okay, great answers. How about a hand for our panel? Taylor, Matthew, Bethel.